Hi everybody, thank you for joining on time. We've seen people joining in quickly. Great to see you guys. Okay, so we have already more than 40 people, so I think without wasting any further time, we should begin with the session. My name is Nikhil and I'm from the alumni team at UpGrad. I welcome you all on behalf of UpGrad for this UpGrad Rise live session on BERT NLP. This is going to be a three-part series, and the part one is today, part two is scheduled for tomorrow, and part three is scheduled for Thursday. Right? This is a certificate series, so if you attend all the three sessions of this series, you will be eligible for a certificate. As expert, we have with us Usha Rengaraju. A lot of you must be knowing her. She is India's first cable expert and DSNML leaders as well. She holds 10 plus years of experience in our field, and it's great to have you back, Usha, for another session. Good evening, Dhirendra. Good evening, Muthu. Great to see you guys. Just to move ahead, we have launched the weekly calendars. We have obviously Google's BERT NLP model, which is a three-part series. We have advanced deployment in ML with Lavi Nigam, who is 40 under 40 data scientist as well. The series starts on Saturday, and the second part is on the next Wednesday. And we have a career excellence workshop as well, which is going to be held on Sunday, 5th September, with Vinny Ajmera. And in case you have not registered for the same, I'll just drop the registration link in the chat box and you can register for the same. Another important announcement that if you want to invite your colleagues, family members, or your buddies to the Career Excellence workshops, you can put up the details in the same registration form and we'll send them a personalized invite. And with this, in case you have any other questions which I can answer or you need any help, with any of the initiatives or any recordings, anything, you can just drop in a line at alumni@upgrad.com. And with this, we are around 80 people already in this session. So without wasting any further time, I'll hand it over to you, Usha.
Yeah. Thanks, Nikhil. It's been my pleasure to come once again to teach for BERT NLP. I think during last computer vision session, you had all requested for NLP BERT session. So this is a three-part session. So the first day we will be, the agenda for the first day is we will look into BERT NLP, just give an overview, introduce you to few concepts, but nothing in deep. We will be just, going through these concepts, I'll just like introduce you to a lot of concepts and you will become familiar with these concepts. It's only tomorrow and day after. We're going to look at a lot of practical implementations and we will be delving deeper into the meaning of these concepts. Today, it's going to be introduction about what the landscape of BERT looks like. And we'll be looking into the history of language models and which had been predecessor before to BERT. And we'll be learning the overview about BERT. We'll be introducing a lot of concepts. And we'll also see a small use case, which is natural language processing with disaster tweets. We'll see how to, use a pre-trained BERT model from TensorFlow Hub to solve this problem. And this is just a basic use case, which is just a sentence classification use case. And it's just a dummy use case, which we are seeing today. And it's only tomorrow and day after we'll be seeing a proper industry use case. Today, it is only for you to get yourself familiar with the BERT NLP. And so let's get started. So this is a research paper here. So what I'll do is I'll quickly create a Word document because, there are people who are going to come later. So you can just, throw the Word document if they ask for, the links. So I'll just create this. BERT NLP. Okay, this is going to be your research paper. And we'll also be going through the research paper tomorrow and day after as well. So this is the research paper, the BERT paper, and there are some famous blogs which you should know about. So that is the J Alumnus blog. He's one of the best bloggers for NLP and computer vision and some of the concepts. He has done it really well. And today's notebook, which we are going to walk through, is finally here. Now I'll share the link. Yeah. So here you go. You have the link to the all the resources in the chat window in a Word document. If somebody joins late and if they ask for the resources, please put the document in the chat box.
Sorry to interrupt, Usha. While messaging, can you please select to everyone? Because currently it is only delivering to host and panelists.
Yeah, I've changed everyone now.
Great.
Yeah, sure. So we are all set now. We'll get started.
Yes, and also just an announcement, guys. I will be updating this reference material link in the recording sheet as well. So you can also take a look from there as well.
Yeah. So if you take this person who is Jay Alumnar, he has done a very good recording. He is even invited by Oxford. He is invited by MIT and all to give lectures. And the reason why he is invited to all these top universities is just because of his blog. I think I've already shared his blog in the last computer vision workshop itself. I had shared this person's blog because that time itself you were asking for NLP materials. I had shared this person's blog. So he's a very good illustrator. So he has like a lot of diagrams to explain concepts in a very, intuitive way. So let's learn about BERT. And before we learn about BERT, there were other architectures like ELMO and ULMFIT. See, this year 2018 was a very, very important year for NLP because it is only in this year it was this ImageNet moment for NLP. So when ImageNet got released for computer vision, it was one of the aha moments where, you know, there were a lot of things which was possible when, you know, very easily it could be done. Before the ImageNet came, there was a lot of struggle with the computer vision space. And after the ImageNet, the computer vision revolutionized itself and there were a lot of things possible. And the same kind of ImageNet moment happened in the year 2018 for NLP. That is when the BERT paper released. This is a BERT paper which got released by Google Brain. This was from the researchers from Google Brain, Google AI language, you can see. The link to the paper is there in the Word. So 2018, when this paper released, and there were a lot of things which was possible, and this BERT pre-trained model, Google also outsourced this BERT pre-trained model, and there were a lot of downstream tasks which achieved a state-of-the-art performance. And so today we're going to learn about BERT. And this BERT, before this BERT, there was one paper called Transformers. And this Transformers paper, again, is from Google Brain Research Team. And this particular paper was from Vaswani et al. And this particular paper also, I'll share the link. This is also one of the very important paper. I'll tell you why Transformers is a very, very important paper. Attention is all you need. This is one of the most important landmark papers as well. The reason is because there are two important architectures which is based on, came out at the same time, which was based on this transformer model. One was GPT, which also was released by OpenAI in 2018. Parallelly, BERT got released by Google again in 2018. And so one difference between GPT and BERT is BERT is an encoder-based architecture. It's only purely encoders, whereas GPT was using decoders, only decoders. So this is the last link is the Transformers paper. This is a very important paper which was revolutionized the NLP industry. And the main author of this paper is this Vaswani. And so you should understand what is transformers. You should understand what is transformers architecture to actually get a good grasp of BERT. Both OpenAI GPT and BERT is based on transformers only. BERT, we will be using only the encoders, whereas the OpenAI GPT, we will be using only the decoders. But transformers will have both encoders and decoders. So you can just check out, and JLMNOS also has got a blog about transformers. So you can also check his blog out if you want to really understand how transformers work. He has got a blog about GPT-3 as well. And it's transformers. Illustrated transformer. This was one of the thing which went viral in the data science community. He has written transformer architectures really well. I'll also share another YouTube video which is equally good for learning transformers in just 15 minutes. This article is also good, and you can actually pair it up with that particular video, so you'll be able to understand transformers really well. So if you see transformers has got both encoders and decoders. See, for transformer is a model where you'll get, for example, one of the natural language tasks is you want to do machine translation, where you want to translate from one language to another language, maybe French to English, and you give French sentence as an input and you get the English sentence as the output. So you have a transformer, which is a black box here. If you just see at the biggest components of transformers is you have encoders and decoders. And if you see encoders, it will not be just one encoder, it will be a bunch of encoders. The number of encoders depends on the hyperparameter based, which you will be tuning based on your architecture. And generally it is 6, but it is a hyperparameter which can be tuned. And decoders is, again, there will not be single decoders, it will be a bunch of decoders. Again, if you see inside this encoder, there'll be a module called self-attention. We'll come back to what is self-attention. And then there'll be a module called feed-forward neural network. I think it's basics of deep learning, which is covered as a part of your academia. I'll come back to what is self-serve. So a single encoder block will contain one self-attention and one feed-forward neural network. Same way, decoder will contain one more additional thing called encoder-decoder attention. But decoder is needed for the GPT only, but for BERT, it is only an encoder-based architecture. If you see the full form of BERT, it is bidirectional encoder representation from transformers. So if you see transformers contains both encoders and decoders, but BERT uses only encoders. It doesn't use decoders. GPT uses only decoders, it doesn't use encoder. So the BERT full form is bidirectional encoder representation from transformers. So if you see transformer, it is an encoder-decoder architecture, but BERT uses only encoders. So I'll come back again. This is a very basic concept, which any one of the natural language processing task is machine translation. You have a French sentence here, you're translating into English. And this transformer architecture will have both encoders and decoders. Encoder means it's not just single box, it is a bunch of encoders stacked up one top of each other. And decoders, again, it is a bunch of decoders stacked on top of each other. And this is how the encoders, decoders will be looking like. So since BERT is bidirectional encoder representation from transformers, we are going to be concerned only about the encoders. So if you're concerned only about the encoders, how does a single encoder block? So it will be like this. You pass the French sentence here, it will go through a series of encoders. The final output of the encoder will be passed to all decoders, and then you will get the final output. This is how the whole architecture looks like. But since BERT depends only on encoders, let's not look into decoders now. Single encoder block will contain self-attention and a feed-forward neural. Feed-forward neural network is nothing but all the nodes in the neurons are connected to every node in the second layer. That is what is a simple feed-forward neural network. But what is self-attention? Self-attention is a new concept which you need to pay attention to. So I'm going to tell you what is self-attention. So for example, if you are having a sentence, if you're having a sentence, the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired. What does it denote here? The animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired. It denotes animal, right? How do you know it denotes animal? So in order to find out that it denotes the animal, what will happen is you will take every word and you will map on to every other word in the sentence so that you can actually get the context of that particular word. So here it denotes the animal. So this process is called self-attention. So if you come back, the encoder architecture contains feed-forward neural network. It's a simple feed-forward neural network. Self-attention is a concept. What is the self-attention concept? You need to understand at the intuitive level. Tomorrow, I'll be teaching you at the mathematics of what is exactly happening, the vector multiplication and all. Today, at the intuitive level, if you want to understand what is self-attention, the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired. Here, it denotes the animal. How can you identify the context here that it denotes animal and it is not referring to any other word? That is done by using a process called self-attention. What happens, the mathematics behind the self-attention, what is happening underneath, we will be unveiling it tomorrow. But now you understand it at the intuition level. So every word is, compared with every other word and to find out which context it refers to. So here it refers to animal. This process is called self-attention. So a single encoder block contains self-attention and feed-forward neural network. So this is about transformers. A basic introduction of transformers, but we are going to see BERT architecture. So transformers we saw, now the BERT is only an encoder architecture. It doesn't have decoders. It's only an encoder architecture. And we will be looking at some of the models which came prior to BERT and what are the disadvantages of it and why we go for BERT. So there is one notebook link which I had shared here, which is the Kaggle notebook link. You can go to this Kaggle notebook link. People who have come late, someone keep posting the notebook, this document link. And so they'll be able to get the resources link. So this is the document which we are going to see. Before BERT came, there were several architectures like ELMO, ULM fit. So ULM fit was one architecture which was revolutionizing this transfer learning in NLP. This ULM fit architecture was the architecture which, after transfer learning in NLP was revolutionized. This paper came from Jeremy Howard. I think all of you will be familiar with fast AI and all that. So this ULM fit revolutionized transfer learning in NLP. And this architecture came before BERT. And before BERT, there was another architecture called ELMO. I don't know how many of you have heard of this ELMO paper. So ELMO was one of the natural language NLP architectures which came before BERT. And so this ELMO was, what is this use of ELMO? To understand ELMO in just an intuitive way. So you just see this picture. ELMO, what's the embedding of the word stick? The multiple possible embeddings, use it in a sentence. So here, if you take stick can be used as a walking stick or stick to the paper. It has several contexts, right? How do you know under which context it has been used? So this ELMO is a paper which familiarizes contextual representation of words. So this contextual representation of words was familiarized by this paper called ELMO. This was a predecessor to BERT. This came before the BERT. But this is similar to BERT in a lot of ways. This is also bidirectional, but it's not deeply bidirectional. It's also bidirectional. But it was using, instead of transformer encoders, it was using LSTMs. So one difference between LSTMs and transformers is, see, if you see RNNs, the biggest problem of RNNs was it cannot, it had the memory problem. It cannot remember long context. It has the reference window of memory for RNN was very small. That's why we went for a better architecture called LSTMK. But LSTM also, the reference window is context, the reference context window is better than RNN, but it is not great. So if you take transformer, transformer has got infinite reference window. So it is much, much better architecture than LSTM. So if you take this ELMO paper, ELMO actually came before BERT. It was also bidirectional, but instead of transformer encoder, it was using LSTM. And it had serious, some of the disadvantages, and it was still performing better in the downstream task and all, but it is not as efficient as transformers architectures like BERT and GPT and all. So this ELMO came before BERT, and we also saw this, ULM FIT also revolutionized transfer learning. Again, it had some disadvantages. Then transformers paper came. And transformers paper was one of the revolutionary point of turning point of NLP. After transformer paper got released by Google Brain, there were several architectures which got released based on that paper. One of the architecture was from a company called, it's a open AI, is an open source initiative. And this open AI released this GPT architecture. It is based on the decoders alone. And then this Google Brain released BERT, which is based on encoders. So this is a little bit history about what happened, what were the architectures before BERT, and what were some of the disadvantages. And now again, in this notebook, there was another, see, even after ULM FIT, ELMO and all, after transformer paper got released, there was one architecture called RNN-based sequence-to-sequence model that is similar to transformer. It also had encoder and decoders. But instead of here, it was RNN-based encoders and decoders. So this model has got some disadvantages, and this was still okay. Because it had encoder decoder architecture. This is again, you have the visualization. So it, you know, the visualization is self-explanatory. You'll be able to understand how this encoder RNN and encoder decoder RNN works. And but this had some disadvantages. You cannot sequence it. You cannot process it parallelly because this follows a sequential processing. So parallel processing was limited, and you had several problems. RNN also, the traditional problem of RNN is vanishing gradient and exploding gradient. The traditional problem of RNN was there. And so there were a lot of disadvantages of this particular architecture. And then this transformers architecture came. And so the transformers, I've already talked about transformers. This is the research paper also I've shared. So if you see transformers, you have something called encoders, you have something called decoders. So this is how the more in-depth architecture looks like, but we will be uncovering all these terminologies tomorrow, because the first day itself, if we go, you will not be able to remember it. So we'll be taking it slowly. Today we'll be introducing several concepts. It's only tomorrow we will be going into the mathematics of it. And day after tomorrow, we should also find time to go. I'll be reading out loud the BERT research paper and explaining the concepts as well. So we'll be going step by step. Today, I'll be explaining the overall intuition. So if you say transformer architecture, the transformer architecture had got this encoder. This is the encoder block. On the left-hand side, you have this tiny thing, right? This is the encoder block, and this is the decoder block. If you see first, you get any sentence. For example, any French sentence or any English sentence you have, you want to translate into French. You take that simple machine translation example. So first, for a sentence, you need to find the word embeddings. So you need, in transformers, one disadvantage of transformers is transformers cannot, transformer architecture cannot remember sequence. See, if you see RNN and all that, RNN, LSTMs and all can remember the sequence, but transformer has a disadvantage, it cannot remember the sequence. So we have some special concepts called positional encoding, which is specifically introduced to remember the sequence. So I love dogs. So I should come first, love should come second, and dog should come third. This is a sequence, right? When you're passing through multiple architectures, there is a possibility the sequence might be lost. The sequence is lost, you may not be able to understand the context of the language. So maintaining the sequence is very important. In order to maintain the sequence, here in transformers, they have introduced the concept called positional encoding. See, in the RNN and all, you don't have to do any positional encoding because the architecture is naturally will maintain the sequence for you because the processing happens sequentially. But here in transformers, the processing happens parallelly. So there is a need to maintain the sequence. So this is what is about the positional encoding. See, tomorrow we will get deeper into positional encoding, how exactly it is done. But today, this is the overall picture of how transformer works. So that is what I'm trying to tell you. So just understand what this positional encoding means. Tomorrow we'll get deeper into the mathematics of it. And so next, what happens is this encoder block. On the left-hand side, you're able to see a block where there are two things, right? This is the encoder block. So in the encoder block, you have the multi-head attention. You have then the normalization layer. So if you see this multi-head attention, there is one residual connection which is going on here, right? So from here, there is one connection which is going straight to the normalization layer. So there is one residual connection. And so this block where multi-head attention and the normalization layer is there, then again, this the output of this sub-block will be passed to a feed-forward layer network, again, normalization layer. Again, there is a residual connection here. So multi-head attention is nothing but the attention, it is processed parallelly. So you're not just processing one token at a time, you're processing multiple tokens at a time. So there will be multiple attention heads. So that is why this is multi-head attention. So this is how an encoder block looks like. A single encoder block will have one sub-block, which is a multi-head attention, and it will have a normalization layer. If you note, there is a residual connection directly from here to the normalization layer. Again, the output will be fed into another block, which is just a feed-forward neural network and the normalization block. Again, this is a residual connection. The output from here is directly fed here to the normalization layer. So if you see the decoder also has the same component as the encoder, but only one block is an addition. That block is nothing, but here you have the masked multi-head attention. So what is masked multi-head attention? We'll come back shortly. Then that's it, you have a linear layer, and finally you have a softmax classifier, whatever job you want to do, whether it is language translation or whether it is sentence classification and all. BERT is famously used for sentence classification task. And so here there is a softmax layer and a linear layer. So what is masked multi-head attention? So BERT is a bidirectional architecture. So what is bidirectional architecture is? So if you see, we went to the river bank, I need to go to the bank to make a deposit. So if you take the sentence to find this word bank, if you just take the sentence on the right side, you may not be able to capture the context really well. At the same time, to make deposit, if you take the sentence on the left side, you may not be able to get the context really well. So you need to take the sentence part from both left side and right side. That is why it is called bidirectional. You're taking the, to predict the word bank, I will take the sentences from the left side and the right side. Not just the left side or right side. I'll take from both sides. That's why it is called bidirectional. Whereas if you take GPT-3, it is not bidirectional. GPT is not bidirectional. GPT is just left to right, only single directional. So that is, BERT is bidirectional. So in order to make a prediction, you will be taking the sentence parts before and on both sides, both left and right side. That's why it's called bidirectional. So there is one disadvantage which can come here. So here one disadvantage is there will be a situation where you should know if you're making a next sentence prediction and when you're training your model, that time you don't want your model to see any supervised learning task you see. You will be keeping aside a certain portion of data to train your model, and certain portion of the data you'll be making a prediction. You don't want your model to see that data, right? Test data, you don't want to expose your model to the test data, right? The same way here, there will be a circumstance where you don't want your model to see what the next word is. So in order to prevent your model from seeing what the next word is, they are using a concept called masking. So that is why this is called masked multi-head attention. So in addition to the encoder, you have one more block, which is called the masked multi-head attention. So this is what is the transformer architecture. and you have the encoders, you have the decoders. Tomorrow we will be going deeper into each of these components, but today I'm just introducing so that you are familiar with what encoders is, what decoders is, and so the self-attention concept I've already discussed. Yeah, the self-attention concept. See, also multi-head attention is nothing but instead of having single attention block, we are parallelly processing multiple layers. That is why it's called multi-head attention. We'll be looking detail into all these concepts once again tomorrow. Today, as long as you understand the overview of transformers, it is more than enough. So this is what is transformer architecture. Transformer architecture will have encoder and decoder. You'll have first positional encoding. Why do we have positional encoding? We have positional encoding because we want the transformers to remember the sequence. We are processing words parallelly here, so the sequence will be lost. So in order to ensure sequence is maintained, why you require sequence? Because language you require, you know, see, only if you have the sequence, you will be able to understand the meaning in the language, right? Maintaining the sequence is very important. That is why you have this concept called positional encoding. You have transformer block, and then you have encoder block, and then you have decoder block. So transformer architecture will have encoder and decoder block. I had already told you transformers will have encoder and decoder block. Encoder is bunch of encoders stacked on one another, and decoder is bunch of decoders stacked on each other. If you take a single encoder, you have a self-attention and a feed-forward neural network. So here, if you see, you have self-attention layer. Instead of it is a multi-head attention because you're processing it parallelly, so there will be multiple attention heads. And after multi-head attention, you have a normalization layer. Then feed forward, then you have a normalization layer. The same thing is for decoders. In addition to that, one more block you have, which is mass multi-head attention. Why you require mask multi-head attention? Because you don't want the transformer, when you're doing next sentence prediction and all, you don't want the transformers to know what the next word is. You want it to predict it. You don't want to already see the answer. So that's why you have something called mask multi-head attention. If you do not understand, don't worry. This is only for you to warm up with these concepts. These concepts exist like that. You want to warm up. So that's why, you know, the concepts are introduced today. Tomorrow, again, these concepts will be revisited. So don't worry if you don't understand it completely today. It's completely okay because we have two more days where by the end of the third day, you'll become thorough with these concepts. Tomorrow, we will go and we will understand how exactly positional embedding is done, how exactly attention is happening, what are the three vectors which are involved in the attention, and all that in detail we'll be looking into tomorrow. So today it is just introducing the concepts to warm you up with the transformer architecture and all. So don't get intimidated. If you understand these are the words which exist in BERT architecture, that's completely fine. So this is what is transformer architecture, and we have introduced a lot of concepts. And next, finally, we are coming to BERT. BERT, as I said earlier, it is bidirectional encoder representation from transformers, meaning it is based on transformer architecture. In transformers, we have both encoders and decoders, but BERT model is based on only encoders. It is called bidirectional. Why it is called bidirectional? Because we want to take the, for example, if you take this word bank here in the second sentence, here the content, to predict this word bank, we take the sentence from both sides, both left and right, both directions we take. That's why it's called bidirectional encoder representations from transformers. And the next thing is, how does BERT work? See, there are several variants of BERT. There are multiple variants of BERT which has come up now, distilly BERT, several variants of BERT and all has come up. But if you take the BERT original architecture, the two variations came. One is the BERT base and one is the BERT. When they released the paper, the two variations which came up, the BERT base architecture and the BERT large architecture. So if you take BERT base architecture, it has got 12 layers. This is only encoder, right? BERT is only encoder, no decoder in BERT. So there were 12 encoder stacks and transformer blocks and 12 attention heads. How many parameters? 110 million parameters. So BERT base was a smaller model And BERT large was a bigger model because you had 24 transformers encoder blocks and you had 16 attention heads and 340 million parameters. If you see the BERT base had similar number of parameters because this GPT and BERT released at the same time. This BERT base has the similar parameters to the GPT. It also has, the GPT also has similar number of parameters. So this BERT base is a smaller model, BERT large is a bigger model, but both has the same architecture. It's just the model is small here. We are only using 12 encoder blocks. Here we are using 24. So the number of encoder blocks which you want to use is a hyperparameter which you can tune. So BERT base uses 12 and BERT large uses, this was released along with the paper. And so if you take the BERT, so should I stop here for 2-3 minutes for you to grasp the concept? If for you, because it is, there's a lot of theory here. So you want to take 2 minutes off to go through what all has been taught so far, or should I continue? Okay, see, don't worry, there are a lot of questions you're having, like what is ad normalization layer, what exactly is happening in layer normalization, what is exactly happening in multi-mask attention and all. Tomorrow we'll be going through this document where, you know, this is explained in detail. So you have, for example, if you take self-attention, so what happens in self-attention? You have three vectors like Q, K, and which is query, key, and value vectors. And this is the embedding of the word. So you'll be multiplying it with them and you'll be getting a new vector. There's a lot which is happening. Self-attention, I just told you the intuition of self-attention. But you, when you actually go and see how self-attention is implemented, there's a lot of concepts involved in that. So we'll be going through this tomorrow. Because if I start explaining all this today, I'm trying to show you the end-to-end picture today. Then once you get the end-to-end picture today, then tomorrow we'll take what all which is taught today, we will take and we will take the same concept, but we will go in much more detail. For example, self-attention itself, there is a lot of concepts which about self-attention and you need to learn. The same way the decoder, how it works also, there's a lot of concepts about decoders. What happens in normalization at each layer? What is the output before normalization? What is the output after normalization? There's a lot of concepts related, but today we are just seeing the intuition. Tomorrow we'll be coming back again and we'll be going through these concepts in much more detail. Today we'll see how the end-to-end flow looks like so that you get an idea of what is the end-to-end flow. And So for BERT, so since most of you said to continue, please do put it in the chat if it's overwhelming and you want a 2 minute break to catch up with whatever is taught so far. And if you don't want the break, I'll just continue. Because this is going to be a lot of theory compared to the previous sessions which I had taken. This is going to be this all 3 days, you will have a lot of theory. And so this may not be, you will have a lot of hands-on also. But theory will come for a considerable amount, at least 45 minutes to 1 hour, there'll be a theory. So if you want like every 25 minutes, you want some 2-3 minutes break, do put it in the, because continuously if a lot of concepts are dumped, it will be difficult for the brain to observe things. And so next, one important thing which you need to learn about BERT is, there is some, before you pass it to the encoder architecture, you need to do some special pre-processing. You need to do some special pre-processing before you pass it to the encoder. Some pre-processing is very important. See, even in your machine learning, supervised learning, machine learning, you're doing a lot of pre-processing, right? You're dropping the null values. You are doing categorical values. You're doing some encoding techniques on categorical values. You are doing a lot of pre-processing even for your supervised machine learning task, right? So BERT has specific pre-processing technique. So what are the specific pre-processing technique in BERT? First, you will get the input. So this is, what is my input? My dog is cute. He likes play. So he likes playing. So this is a sentence. So first pre-processing, what I'll do is I'll insert a token, special token called CLS. CLS stands for classifier here. I'll insert the first token will be CLS. Then the first sentence, one separator for this sentence, which is SCP. SCP stands for separator, then the second sentence, and the end of the second sentence as a separator. So the first input itself, you will format like that. Input you will take, you'll insert CLS token in the beginning. Then after every sentence, you will insert a token called SCP. So you have the first token, which is CLS. After every sentence, you will have a token called SCP separator. This is the first processing you'll do. Then you have three more processing. Token embeddings is similar to the word embeddings. For every word, you will have an embedding vector, right? This is in general NLP, you would have learned about word embeddings and all that, right? So what is the use of word embeddings? Word embeddings is introduced so that you are able to maintain the contextual information. So that is why word embeddings was introduced. Word embeddings is nothing but vectors, vector representation of words, that's all. So for every word, I'm going to put the word embeddings. Token embeddings is every word. Token is word here, every word. Every word, I'm putting the word embeddings. So if you see ECLS, this is just some generic representation given here, but it will be, the second will be having the my word embedding. Then here you will have the dog word embedding like that. Third layer, you will have something, it is not segment, it is sentence embeddings, I think. I'm not sure if it is segment or sentence, I think segment only. So you have something called sentence embedding or segment embedding, I'll just confirm. Yeah, it is segment only. You have something called segment embeddings. The reason why you have segment embeddings, you want to differentiate the first sentence and the second sentence. So my dog is cute is the first sentence. So all the one embedding you will introduce to mention that this, all these four words are first, belongs to first sentence, and you will introduce another embedding vector to denote that he likes playing, it belongs to the second sentence. That is what the use of segment embeddings. Position embeddings is transformer processes parallelly. So you will not be by naturally, it cannot maintain the sequence. So you need to have some vector representation to maintain the sequence of words. That is done using this vectors. So any vector, if you take the, for every single word, your vector representation will be the combination of all three, token embeddings, segment embeddings, and position embeddings. What each of these embedding, token embedding is just the word embedding for that token. Segment embedding is to differentiate whether it belongs to first sentence or second sentence or third sentence. Position embedding is to maintain the sequence. So for any given token, it is a combination of all the three embeddings. This is the pre-processing which has to be done for BERT. So BERT is special. It has some pre-processing requirement. And the pre-processing requirement in BERT is like that. Any sentence or sequence of sentence you take, you will have the first token as the classifier. It's a special token, which is CLS. And every sentence is divided by an SCP token. And then you have a series of tokens, embeddings, which has to be done. The first embedding is the token embedding, which is just the word embedding. And the segment embedding is to differentiate the sentences, and position embedding is to maintain the sequence. So this is a special pre-processing which has to be done for BERT. Hope this is clear. And after this, if you did not understand also, please don't worry, because the entire thing, I'll be repeating it once more, because some people have joined late and on. So I'll be repeating it twice. So please be patient. By the time, second time I repeat it, you will be able to fix the parts which you're not able to understand. So it is a lot of theory, because you will have to understand the architecture and all. And you'll be understanding the architecture in parts. Today we'll be just introducing the intuition of concepts. Tomorrow is when we are going to go in deeper into it. So if you just understand the overall end-to-end flow, then that's great. So the first thing is, in BERT, we will be doing two steps. One is the mass language modeling. And the second thing is the next sentence prediction. So what is this mass language modeling? Mass language modeling is randomly 15% of the words. What we will do is we will mask it. Mask it is, we'll make it nullified. there will be zeros there. There will not be, the words will be removed and just a mask value will be put. So 15% of the words, we will be masking it. And we'll be randomly picking these 15% of words, and randomly the words will be masked. So in mass language modeling, there's two steps in BERT. First step is the way, this is, I'm talking about the BERT training. You have the architecture, but how are you actually training the architecture? So for training, we have two steps. The first training you will do is, you will randomly mask 15% of the words, and you will be, now you will be training your model to predict these masked words. That is called mass language model. That is, you will mask the word and your model has to predict the word. So for example, in this example, what I'll do is, if I mask this bank, your model has to read, I need to go to, and it has to predict bank. It will read to make a deposit and it will predict the bank. This bank will be masked. Some masked characters will be written here. So you'll be randomly masking 15% of the words, and you will be making your training your model to predict those masked words. That is the first part of the training for BERT model. This is called BERT mass language modeling. So if you see the mass language modeling architecture, the way it looks like this, you have the word embedding architecture, all the positional embedding, all the embedding part, you do it here. Then you will be releasing it to the transform. BERT has only encoders, right? So you'll be releasing it to the encoder architecture. The output of the encoder architecture, you will be passing it into a classification layer. So this classification layer is what will predict. Okay, certain word is masked. I love my dog. Here, if my dog is masked, only I love is there, then my model, this classification layer will predict I love comes, means the third word, the dog is masked. It will predict the third word is dog. So this is what the classification layer will do. It will predict the masked words, the 15% of words which were masked, it will predict. This is how the training of the model will happen in the first phase. The first phase is the masked language. Don't worry if you don't understand it completely. If you just understand, you know, the overall flow, this is how training means. Training happens in two phases. First phase, it's a mass language. What it is and all, tomorrow we will be covering it. But today, if you just get the intuition of it, then it's more than enough. Tomorrow, we'll be breaking down the same concepts. And we have also the next sentence prediction. And the next sentence prediction is, so if you have... if you are given a new sentence, two sentences, you will have to predict if the second sentence in the given paragraph, if the second sentence follows the first sentence or not. If the second sentence is following the first sentence or it is coming at somewhere else. This is the second part in the next BERT training phase. So this is the next sentence prediction. So training of BERT involves two things. One is the mass language model and the other is the next sentence prediction. What is next sentence prediction is, see, my dog is cute, he likes playing. You will have to, in the literature or in the corpus, my dog is cute, the next sentence is he likes playing. So you have to predict, your model has to predict, if the he likes playing comes after my dog is cute, or it doesn't come after, it has to say he likes cute comes after, he likes playing comes after my dog is cute, or it doesn't come after my dog is cute. This is what your next sentence prediction has to do. What next sentence prediction will do is, if this given sentence will come after the first sentence or not, whether it will come or it will not come, that you will have to predict. This is what the next sentence prediction does. So your BERT training involves two phases. One is the mass language modeling and the next sentence prediction. There will be a lot of concepts, theoretical concepts to understand. But if you can get your head around it, tomorrow we'll be delving deeper into these concepts. And so the next sentence prediction, then you have the BERT fine tuning. So if you see BERT model, see the same BERT can be used for question answering. The same BERT I can use for classification tasks like classifying the sentiments of a novel. I can also use for name entity recognition in a bunch of text. I'll be able to predict this is this is location, this is organization. I can also do name entity recognition tasks. I can use the same BERT for solving several downstream tasks. But how can I use the same word for doing several? Very simple. All I need to do is add one layer extra. That's all. Fine-tuning BERT is very easy compared to fine-tuning other architectures which came before BERT. Fine-tuning BERT is very easy. For example, if you take classification task, I'll just add one more classification block layer above the existing BERT architecture. And for question answering means, then I need to add two extra vectors. That's it. If it is name entity recognition is for every token, I should have an extra NER label which will tell what entity it is. So like small modification if you can do, just adding one extra layer, just adding appending one extra vector, small modification, you will be able to solve multiple tasks. This is the advantage of fine-tuning BERT. You just have to make small changes to the architectures by you can solve multiple task classification or question answering or other glue tasks or things like that. And so for example, and one more thing, some of the takeaways here in BERT is, if you take BERT base versus BERT large is obviously a bigger model. It has got 340 million parameters. So it is, if you take any benchmark task, the BERT large will give you better performance. Obviously, it will give you better performance. And if you want to increase your performance, the way you increase this is to have more training data and you to train it for longer epochs, you will be able to increase your performance. And so these are some of the takeaways. And you also have, you know, how long it takes to train BERT base from the scratch and how long it takes to train BERT large from the scratch. See, most of the time in real time, you will not be training from the scratch. It's going to take days and not everyone has got that kind of an infrastructure at home. How many people have got A100s at home and 309, RTX 3090 at home? How many people have got that kind of an infrastructure at home? You require multiple GPUs here, not just single A100. You require multiple GPUs to train it from the scratch and it will take days. Not everyone can do that. The pre-trained model is really open source. Most of you will be just fine-tuning it to solve your task. Nobody is going to train the BERT from the scratch. You'll just do fine-tuning. So this is about the theory. We are going to take a small toy use case and I'm going to teach you how to use BERT to solve that use case. This is a sentence classification use case. Are you clear with the theory or should we revise the theory once more before we go to the use case? The BERT theory, how many of you are okay? See, you don't have to understand deeper because, you don't have to understand deeper. I'm telling it several times because the session is for 3 days. Today, we are learning the ABCs of BERT. Tomorrow, we will learn how to write sentences. And on the third day, you will be able to write paragraphs. So today, do you understand the ABCs of BERT? Do you understand what and all exists inside BERT? That is what you should... Some people want to go to the use case and some people want to revise. Majority. Okay, don't worry. I think you guys can see the answer. Some of you want to use case, some of you want to revise. Quick revision. Okay, 50% revise and 50% use case. Can we, the friends who are able to understand it, can I do a 5 to 7 minutes quick revision for the people who are not able to understand? In that 5 to 7 minutes, you can take a quick coffee break or some small break. By that time, I'll do a small revision, not 5 minutes, less than 5 minutes. I think it's going to take 3 minutes. I'll take 3 minutes to revise the concepts once again. Is that okay? 3 minutes. In that 3 minutes, you can go drink water and come take a loo break so that the people, some people have mentioned they are slow and they want a revision. See, some of you are already data scientists working. So you will be like very familiar with already these terminology. It will be revision, but some people, it is totally new. So first time when they're hearing it, it will be very overwhelming. So for their, for the sake of them, I'm just repeating it very quickly. Please take the people who already know, you can go drink water and you can take a short break. Okay, so what is BERT? BERT is bidirectional encoder representation from transformers. This is one kind of an architecture, NLP architecture, which came out in 2018. For the people who came late and who are a little slow, please pay attention. I'm repeating it for the second time. BERT architecture was released by Google Brain in 2018. It is one of the architecture which revolutionized the NLP space. Before 2018, we were in a very comfortable phase in the computer vision side. Computer vision was booming, but only NLP was like dead slow. But after this transformer paper release and BERT architecture came out, NLP had its ImageNet moment in 2018 when it got BERT was released by Google Brain. So this BERT is one of the revolutionizing architecture which has come out. So BERT stands for bidirectional encoder representation from transformers. What is so it is something from transformers. So the architecture is taken from the transformers paper. So transformers was one paper which was released by again Google Brain. That paper is called Attention is All You Need. It is from Google Research. The main author is Vaswani et al. He is one of the important authors who released this paper. And it's again from Google Brain. So if you take the transformer architecture, it can be used for any, you can take any NLP task. Like machine translation is one of the NLP tasks. Here I'm having a French sentence and I want to translate into English. Then, you know, I have a transformer block. Inside the transformer block, I have encoders and decoders. If you take encoders, encoders is a bunch of encoders stacked on top of each other. And decoder is a bunch of decoders stacked on top of each other. So it is, and if you take a single encoder, you have self-attention and feed-forward neural network. We will be learning about self-attention in detail tomorrow, but the intuition of self-attention is, for example, if I have a sentence, the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired. It stands for animal here, but how do I know it stands for animal? The way I do it, I'll be able to know it stands for animal is, I'll take every word and I will be like mapping it with every other word to understand that particular word maps on strongly to which word. So here the it actually denotes the animal. This process is called self-attention. And so self-attention is one of the most important concepts in BERT. We'll be looking into it tomorrow. And so this is what the encoder, single encoder architecture looks like. And I hope you have understood it. And next, when you come for BERT architecture, the reason why it is called bidirectional is, if you see, I need to go to the bank to make a deposit. Bank is the important word we are going to mask. In order to predict this bank, I will be able to predict, I should be able to predict it from by using I need to go to dash, I should be able to predict back and dash to make a deposit. So it takes the context from both sides. It is not just taking the context from, it is not predicting a word based on taking the part from one side. It is taking the context from both sides and trying to predict the word. This is why it is called bidirectional. Whereas if you take an architecture like GPT, it is not bidirectional. It is just left to right architecture. So for GPT, you will be just taking left to right. So you'll be just taking, I need to go to, you'll not take to make the deposit, you'll not take, you'll just take left to right. So GPT architecture is like that, but bidirectional, BERT is like, it takes from both the direction. And if you BERT, by the time when it got released, two architectures was released. One is after BERT got released, after a few months, several architectures came up, several papers came up based on that. But during the time of release, there were two famous architectures which came out. One is the BERT base and the BERT large. BERT base is a tiny model and BERT large is a big model. Tiny model in the sense, number of encoder, BERT is the main component of BERT is from transformers, you're just taking the encoders alone. You're not using decoders in BERT, right? GPT uses decoders. BERT uses encoders. So in BERT base, it is a tiny model. It has only encoders. It has only 12 layers. BERT large is a bigger model. It has got 24 layers. So it has a lot of encoders. Okay, this is the and if you see the number of parameters for BERT base, it is 110 million parameters. And BERT large, it is 340 million parameters. And so then one more thing which you need to understand, this is about BERT. And one more thing, there are three things which you need to understand about any architecture, any NLP architecture you take. You need to understand three important things. First thing is, how do you train that architecture? That is very important. Does the architecture has got any specific pre-processing requirement? BERT has got specific pre-processing requirement. You need to do certain kind of pre-processing before you start training. So pre-processing is very important. And how do you train the model is important. Finally, see, one BERT is one architecture, but we use it for several downstream tasks. Language translation, we use it for question answering, we use it for sentiment classification. How can you use single architecture for multiple tasks? By using a process called fine-tuning. So these are very important things. Pre-processing, training the model, fine-tuning. These are three important components which you need to understand. Let's get started with pre-processing the BERT. What is the specific pre-processing requirements for BERT? So if you take the BERT, if my dog is cute, he likes playing. My dog said cute, the first token is the classifier. CLS is a special token, which is the classifier token. And after every sentence, to distinguish this is first sentence, this is second sentence, there is a special token called release. That is to differentiate the first and second sentence, we have a token called SCP. SCP is also at the end of the second sentence. So differentiating the different sentences, you have SCP. But in addition to this, we'll have three types of embeddings. For every word, you will have three embeddings combined together. What are those three embeddings? The first one is a token embedding, which is just a normal word embeddings. And next is a segment embedding. Segment embedding is one vector which will denote this belongs to the first sentence and this will belongs to second sentence, this belongs to third sentence. So it actually stores a vector for storing the sentence number. And position embeddings was a vector for storing the sequence of the word. And so these are the three embeddings. And if you combine these three embeddings together, you will be able to get the final embedding vector. So BERT has got this specific pre-processing technique requirement. So you need to do this specific pre-processing for BERT, okay? And so we have three things. One is pre-processing, next is training the model, and then fine-tuning. So in training, how is BERT trained? BERT training happens in two phases. The first phase is called mass language model and the second is called next sentence prediction. Don't worry if you don't understand it in deeper. Because tomorrow, I think last day, what I'll be doing is after you are familiar with all the concepts, you would have seen at least two. See, today use case is dummy use case. But tomorrow I'll be trying to take, tomorrow and day after I'll try to take a proper current Kaggle competition if possible or some very strong Kaggle competition and I'll be teaching Hugging Face libraries and all where, you know, you just like 4 or 5 lines of code, you can solve many, many tasks very, very easily. So all that you will be seeing it tomorrow. And when we get time on the last day, what we will do is, in the last 2-3 days, you will be learning all the concepts. Slowly, slowly, you will get familiarized with all the concepts. Last day, what we will do is we'll sit for 30 to 40 minutes. We'll read out every paragraph and I'll start explaining you. It will be like a revision. We'll take the research paper of the BERT and we'll read every paragraph and we will revise it. So by the time we come to this research paper and read every paragraph, by the time you will become familiar with all the concepts. So the familiarity comes and the expertise comes in step by step. You will not be able to become an expert in just like that. So you need to have some patience to master the concepts. So now you just understand what is mass language modeling. So if you again, when you go to the paper, you will find in detail what is a mass language modeling. So they would have explained it in detail. So pre-training BERT. So in pre-training BERT, you have two steps. One is the mass language modeling. The next is the next sentence prediction. So here again, on the last day, we will be going through every line and you will be able to understand it much better. So today, again, next sentence prediction. Again, this is the next sentence prediction. So tomorrow, last day, we'll be revising it once again. So for now, you just understand the gist of it. Mass language modeling, what we do is, we randomly mask 15% of the words we randomly mask. And we try to predict those masked words. This is what happens in mass language modeling. So this is how the architecture looks like. You have the word embeddings where you have the three embeddings for every single word. You have three embeddings which will be added together. Then you will pass it to the transformers, encoders. Here, just one block is there. It just must have as a bunch of encoders stacked on top of each other. After it comes out of the final encoder stack, you'll get the output. That output, again, you'll put one more classification layer on it, which will actually predict that masked word. This is what is masked language modeling. The first step of pre-training is masked language modeling. The second step of pre-training is the next sentence prediction. Next sentence prediction is, you have to say, my dog is cute, he likes playing. Whether he likes playing comes after my dog is cute or not. Here, he likes playing comes after my dog is cute. So yes, it comes after I do. So that is what the next sentence prediction. You're trying to predict whether the next sentence follows the first sentence or not. That is very literal meaning, whether the next sentence follows the first sentence or not. This is the second step in the BERT pre-training. Hope this is clear. And this is what is the next sentence prediction. So these are the two pre-training. If you take pre-training of BERT, you have the first task is a mass ELF, which we saw 15% of the task, we are randomly masking it. And then we are actually, there are a lot to the mass language modeling. So that there is one more important concept to the mass language modeling. This we will be seeing it on the last day. But for now, you just get the gist of it. And next is the next sentence prediction. Next sentence prediction, you'll have to predict whether the second sentence is the follows the first sentence or not. So this is what is in the pre-training of BERT. Finally, you have the fine-tuning of BERT. Fine-tuning is where you use the same BERT architecture for solving several tasks. Whether here I've just named three, but there are a lot of tasks which you can solve using BERT, more than 12 or something, which they have mentioned in the paper, like 19 or 12, I'm not sure. So classification task, if you see sentiment, movie analysis, review, and all these is classification task. And you don't have to do much anything. Fine tuning is very easy, where you just add a classification layer and you will be able, one single classification layer, you just have to add in addition to the existing architecture, you can solve any classification task. If you want to add question answering, you need to add two vectors, beginning that is in a bunch of paragraph. In a paragraph, your answer will be in some way, it starts somewhere and it'll end somewhere, right? So that beginning and end vector alone, you will have to mention for question answering. For name entity detection, for every word, you need to give the label of what entity it belongs to. So small modification, you will be able to solve several tasks. This is about the fine tuning of BERT. And so far we have revised the theory. We will be looking at a very small dummy toy use case for you to, because it shouldn't be a two theory session. So some dummy use case for you to get the hang of it. But in reality, you will not be using TensorFlow Hub and all, because mostly you'll be using Hugging Face library only. I'll be introducing Hugging Face tomorrow. But for you to just get the feel of some hands-on today. So this is the data set we are looking at, natural language processing with disaster tweets, which means you have the movie classification, right? Your movie classification, you're making a classification, whether it is a positive review or negative review, right? Same way, you are making a classification review, whether the tweet belongs to a disaster or it is not a disaster tweet. This is a problem statement. Natural language processing with disaster tweets means all of you, I think everyone in this class will be familiar with this movie classification example, right? Any course you take, that will be the use case. So that movie classification and sentiment analysis, everyone will be, you all know this classification where you make positive sentiment, negative sentiment. Same use case only, but here it is little different. You have to classify if a particular tweet is a disaster tweet or it is a tweet not related to any disaster. You just have to classify this. This is the data set we are going to do, and we are going to solve this using the BERT. And so you have just a minute, I'll drink water. You have trained CSV, you have test CSV, and you have sample submission CSV. So if it is disaster tweet, it is zero, or if it's not a disaster tweet, you will predict one. You have trained CSV where you have the tweets, and you have the test CSV, which also has the tweets, which you will just make a prediction on. So this is a data set. What we are going to do is we are going to use BERT to classify if it is a disaster tweet or it is not a disaster tweet. Here we are also using something called TensorFlow Hub. How many of you have heard of TensorFlow Hub? How many of you have heard of MNLI is multi-genre language inference? Nobody has learned of TensorFlow Hub. So I'll teach you what is TensorFlow Hub. So TensorFlow Hub means it is a huge repository of TensorFlow pre-trained models. So the Google had released all the BERT pre-trained models in the TensorFlow Hub. So if you will be CL. So if you go to this TensorFlow Hub, you will find a huge repository of pre-trained models, which means it is already trained. You don't have to train from the scratch. Not everyone can train from the scratch, right? Does everyone have 4 to 5 A100s here? No, right? I am not sure even if anybody has A100 in your house right now. So very few people will be able to afford GPUs. I think RTX 3090 itself is like 2.5 lakhs and the A100 will be like 7 to 8 lakhs. I'm not sure. In the market, you will be getting that rate. But if you have some founder edition or if you know people in NVIDIA, you will get discount and all. That you can get it cheaper. So GPUs are costly. So not everyone can sit and train models from the scratch. That is why Google has made this TensorFlow Hub platform where there is a huge repository of pre-trained models. So you can take these pre-trained models and you can use it to just make small modifications. Sometimes even without making modification, you can start solving your problems. So this is a great advantage. And I'll also put the link of this thing like TF Hub. So this is the link of TensorFlow Hub. And one more thing is this is not just for BERT. If you see text problem domains, you have a lot of problems, image problems, video problems, audio problems. So you can literally solve problems using multiple domains. So there are around 1,400 to 500 pre-trained models, and you can solve problems from all these pre-trained models. So you got the hang of what TensorFlow Hub is, right? So if you want to, for example, in video classification, you click on video classification, there are several TensorFlow pre-trained models. You can go choose the model you want to solve your particular task. So we are going to use a particular TensorFlow version hub, a BERT model, which is present in TensorFlow Hub. And not be going into every line of code. The reason is because in reality, you will not be using this TensorFlow Hub or not. You'll be only mostly ending up using Hugging Face libraries. So this is just for you to get a feel of hands-on because you have learned too much of theory. Only if you have some hands-on, you'll be able to get the intuition of it much better. So I'm showing this example, but tomorrow we'll be looking into Hugging Face and the other libraries out there, which are most important, most likely to be used in real world. You know, you might be using it in your projects real time, but not TensorFlow Hub. I rarely doubt. Maybe for quick prototyping, you can do it. That is small experiment you want to do it, then you can do it. So what I'm going to do is this part of the code imports all the libraries. Every line of code I will not be going through. You just care if you understand the flow, that's more than enough because this is not very important. So if you just understand the flow, that's more than important. This is all the packages which you require, you will be importing it. So as I have already told you, BERT has some specific requirements of embeddings and tokenizing and all that. So we have to import something called tokenizer. So tokenizer will be very, very important. So we are having the tokenization file in this particular location from that. Tokenization from a particular one, give me a minute. See, you have the tokenizer at this particular location, and you're just you'll have to download it, and then you'll import tokenization, and then you have helper functions. There are two helper functions. One helper function is where you have the model built. It accepts the model, and it accepts the max length parameter. Here you will be building the words, mask, segment IDs, and all the pre-processing input mask, segment IDs, and all that. And then you will be instantiating the model, then you will be compiling it, and you will run it. In the compilation, you will mention the learning rate, binary, what loss, what metrics, and all that. And this is a function for the helper function for it. And there's also another helper function, BERT encode, where you will have the pre-processing. So if you take the pre-processing here, we learned about this, right? Token embedding, sentence embedding, and what is a positional encoding. So this particular helper function takes care of it, where you will be doing all the positional. First, you will have the CLS token, then you will have text, and then after every sentence, you will have the separator token. Then you have the, the segment tokens. And then you also have the other thing, which is the positional token and all this added. So this particular helper function takes care of all the encoding related things. And from the main part is, so till here we have seen the helper functions and the importing and all. The main part is here. So if you go to TensorFlow Hub, why TensorFlow Hub is very easy for many of the tasks. For example, if you take language models here. So I'm just clicking on this particular model. I have a URL here. I have a URL here, which is like that particular URL is, I'll be giving that URL, and then I will be, doing this hub Keras layer. I'll be putting this module layer and trainable too. So this is what is, if I just take this URL and then instantiate hub.keras layer, pass this URL there, I'll be able to get my pre-trained model. This hub.keras layer is nothing but the import function here. Here you are importing TensorFlow Hub as hub. So the alias for TensorFlow Hub here while importing, you're using hub. So if you put hub.keras layer and pass the URL, you will be able to get your pre-trained model. So all the pre-trained models here will have a URL. You can just copy the URL and you can use it. So this is just as easy as it is, just two lines of code where we will be able to get the pre-trained model in two lines of code. Is that okay? You will get the pre-trained model in two lines of code, and then you will load all the data, train test data, submission data. You will perform tokenization, and then you will be doing the encoding. After you encode, you will be just building the model. You're calling this build model helper function, which will actually build the model. And this is the model summary. Then you're training the model for just three epochs. You can try it for some 10 to 15 epochs. And then you will start making a prediction. If it is zero, it is a disaster tweet. If it is one, it is not a disaster tweet. This main part, what you need to understand is these two lines. What is the advantage of using TensorFlow Hub? Before this, you have pre-processing, and after this, some basic mundane tasks. So you don't have to do any training here. We're writing just two lines of code. I can take the pre-trained model from this location, and I can solve my problem. I did not do much training here. I just took the model from this TensorFlow Hub. I just wrote two lines of code. There's not much of a training I'm doing here. And I'm able to solve my problem. The problem statement here is sentence classification. So this is a quick example how you can use a pre-trained model from TensorFlow Hub, and you can start solving your task. Here we have solved sentence classification. You can also, tomorrow we'll see other types of tasks like question answering, another inference task and all in natural language processing. So this is how, this is to give you an understanding. I don't want you to understand every line of code because this is, we'll not be using TensorFlow Hub much. So here it is just for you to, get a basic intuition. You are just importing files here. This tokenization file is here. You're downloading from the location, importing it. You have a couple of helper functions. The one helper function for building a model and the other helper function, which will take care of all the encoding. Here we studied all the encoding, right? All the encoding will be taken care of by that helper function. Then you are going and you are downloading this bird from this URL. You have your pre-trained model. You're just initializing hub.keras layer, passing that URL. You'll be able to get your pre-trained model. That's it. Then just usual data pre-processing where you get the CSV file converted into a pandas data frame. Tokenization is one of the important process here. So that will be taken care by the tokenizer, which you imported. And then encoding, we saw there are three important encodings here. You'll be encoding the training data, test data as well. And then you will be building your model and then you will be making a prediction. If you just get the overall view of what the code does, that's more than enough. You don't have to focus on every line or not. Because Hugging Face, literally, you don't have to write helper function and all that. Just can get sentence classification done in single line of code using Hugging Face library. So that's why I don't want you to confuse with the codes. Please don't try to understand every line of code. The reason is tomorrow we'll be seeing a Hugging Face library where for accessing the same BERT model, we will write a single line of code to access BERT base. So and then you will be able to get this problem solved. So if you just understand the intuition of what BERT is, how it is used to solve problems, that's more than enough. If you just understand the ABCs of BERT, because tomorrow again, we'll be taking the same concepts we learned today, but we will be digging much deeper because today we did not see the mathematics of it, underlying of it, or what each concept means in much more depth. We'll be doing it tomorrow. So if you have any questions, we'll open up for questions now. And or if you are not thorough in any particular part, you want it to be repeated, then we can go for it or we'll start the question. Yes, you can actually, I have one question. Can we specify how many layers to retrain? Yes, you can do all those fine tuning, but for the sentence classifications, it's a straightforward thing. And maybe if you're doing other tasks, if you can actually specify it. Can BERT run in 2 GB NVIDIA graphics with 64 GB RAM laptop? See, you're not going to train BERT, right? You're only going to use a pre-trained model and do fine tuning. So I think that should work. It will take some 1 hour or something like that, or 1.5 hours, maybe a hour or so, but you can do it. You can do it using that. You're only going to do fine tuning, right? You don't take, even with the normal ordinary graph GPUs, you can do it. Tomorrow we'll be looking into deeper again into the pre-training of model. Tomorrow we will go through the pre-training of model once again. We will take each and every concept which we learned today and we will be learning it in much more detail. So when I say in detail, for example, if you take this concept, encoder, if you take attention, we just saw what is attention, but if we will take every vector and I know how it is passing through every layer, what is the output which is coming up, how it looks like, and all this much more and deeper, even the concept of self-attention. And it is a very big concept. Concept of self-attention is a very big concept. And that itself will take 20 minutes to explain. And we'll take, many of you had doubts like layer, what will happen at layer normalization. We just brushed through the concept like there is residual network, layer normalization, masked multi-head attention and all that. But tomorrow we'll go much deeper into it. It is just an introduction class today. And so all the concepts we learn, we'll study deeper. I'll take some important questions, which will be, ma'am, is T5 training better than the BERT? So it depends on use case to use case. Sometimes BERT is good. Sometimes a lot of people, they are using Robota here, ExcelNet. If you take most of the research paper, they'll give you the recent research paper, NLP papers, which are coming. In the last page, they'll give you a statistics. They would have compared all the models like BERT, Robota, DistilleBERT, and all the models they would have compared, all the recent architectures, ExcelNet, and all the architecture they'll compare, and they'll give you a statistics which is performing best for that particular task. This in the 2021 research paper, you take most of the research paper will have this statistics. So it depends from use case to use case. So for which use case, which model is performing best, you will get it from, you just take for download 4 to 5 recent 2021 research paper, you will get that statistics. What was BERT we will be looking on the final day, we will be looking at the variation of BERTs like Robota, DistilleBERT, and other BERT architectures. We will be looking at on third day. I'll cover that. How is BERT different from Robota and other similar BERT flavors? We'll be covering it on third day. See, if for BERT, you have multiple tokenizers. Each tokenizer is used for different purposes. Tomorrow, if we have time, tomorrow or on the third day, preferably, we'll go through the different tokenizers in the Hugging Face library. Because Hugging Face is what you'll be using it frequently. So we'll go through different tokenizers in the Hugging Face on third day. See, all the link, can somebody put the links today we shared in the chat window?
Usha, can you also take some questions from the Q&A tab?
Yeah.
Sure, thanks.
So will you be teaching BERT-based models like DistilleBERT, yes, BERT, Robota, yes. Sumit Dwivedi, yes. On the third day, we will be covering DistilleBERT, yes, BERT, Robota. We'll be discussing it. And this transformer encoder, what is the need to use residual connection to normalization layer? Tomorrow, we'll be looking into it. All the residual layers, in deeper, why we require normalization there, what is layer normalization? Layer normalization is a very basic concept, but I'll be revising it once again. It's a deep learning concept which you need to know, but I'll revise it once again tomorrow. By the end of the session, can we get a sample code of nice working project of using BERT so we can try on the machine and explore more? Sure. What I'll do is for today, we saw one dummy example, but tomorrow and day after, we will be looking into two or I'll give you at least in the class, I'll go through two use cases with proper real world scenarios. I'll also give one takeaway use case. So at least I'll try to cover 2 to 3 use case, real world use cases, which you can use it as a takeaway. And is BERT a word embedding or a model? It's an NLP architecture. It's not word embedding. Word embedding is, what is the concept of word embedding? Word embedding is, see, for example, if you just convert any word into a vector, you are losing the context there. Yeah? You're just converting a word into a number. You are losing the context there, right? So you want to retain the context also. So in order to, if you want to retain the context, for example, if you take, cat and dog. Cat and dog both are animals and both are pet animals. So there is some context where relationship between cat and dog, right? Both are pet animals and can be kept at home. So there is some relation. Both are animals, but at the same time, they're different. So there's contextual relationship between the word cat and dog. Word embeddings will capture those contextual representation as well. If you just convert merely word into numbers, the contextual representation is not captured. But if you word embeddings, the contextual representation is also captured. You get a vector which will actually denote the context as well, how close it is related to the other words as well. What can be the max number of encoders you said in this hyper? See, the BERT base models, which is the biggest model with 340 million parameters, has got 24 encoders, right? So there is nothing stopping you from adding more encoders, but you see BERT was trained by Google, which had the biggest architecture, but do you have the right kind of architecture to train it? That is more important. So bird base, there is nothing stopping you from adding more architecture. If you have the biggest infrastructure at your home, if you have some 15A100 and 15 3090s and you have like unlimited RAM, then you can add even some 20-30 encoders. There's nothing stopping you. But the bird base, which is the biggest model, that model has got 340 million parameters and that has got 24 encoders. And given a particular NLP text classification task, how do you decide between Roberta and Distilly Bird? Or bird, given that Roberta gives the best evaluation results, given Distilly. So this, it is, as I already told you, you will find it in the research paper, Sumit. But don't worry, tomorrow I will download some 3 to 4 research paper and I'll share the links. And I'll also take and I'll show the comparison for every glue task, which model performs best. This is available. The statistics will be available in all research papers, but I'll take and download and I'll keep the papers which has the statistics and I'll show it in class tomorrow. Remind me. And you said BERT can be fine-tuned for question answering task, any task and classification task. Can you cover the use cases for all these? Sure, I will cover the notebooks, Kaggle notebooks for all these tasks. I'll be covering the Kaggle notebooks. Thanks for asking this question. And which one is preferred between BERT Large and Roberta, given that both use complex neural network architecture compared to pre-trained models? It depends on the use case to use case. Tomorrow, I'll show you the comparison of for which glue task, for example, for question answering, which is the best model currently available. For sentence classification, what is the best model which is currently? There are a lot of models which has come out this year and all, right? So tomorrow, I'll show you the comparison. What is attention head in transformer? What exactly we mean by head? So attention is, head is a block, that is all. It's just a block, it's a network layer, that's it. Attention is just the literal meaning of attention also makes sense here. What you're doing when you say attention, you're focusing on that particular task, right? When you say attention. Here also in BERT, when you say self-attention, it means you're taking that single word and trying to find the context amongst all the other words. But when you say attention, you're trying to focus on a particular part of a sentence or things like that. Tomorrow I'll try to compare the difference between attention and self-attention. How can we come up with our own pre-trained models like BERT? I should mean how POC on existing transformer architecture. There's something called neural architecture search, which you can use for coming up with your own neural network architectures. You can just check out neural architecture search. Maybe that can help you out for coming up with your own architecture. You just have to, you can take the BERT code as the base and you can just add few more encoder layers or decrease few more layers. Just play around with number of architectures you're using. And if you do research along with 5 to 6 people, then you may want to do a positional encoding differently, or you want to do the, you want, instead of, you can remove few encodings, or you can add some new extra layers. You can just keep experimenting with it and then start training. Maybe I'll answer that question better in the upcoming days, but for now, I think this answer should be okay. Is better always better than GPT, LSTM, RNN, transformer? See, you can't say like that. If you say BERT, BERT is not that great for machine translations, whereas GPT is very good for machine translation. At the same time, BERT is not good for text generation and all, but GPT is very good for text generation. It is very excellent in text generation. So some use cases BERT is good, some use cases BERT is not that great. And so yeah, both of us, GPT is good in certain things, but not good in certain things like that. Madhusudanan, applications of BERT and GPT, can both be used for any use case or are there specific? See, both can be used for all glue tasks and most commonly used tasks. But it is just the performance wise, for example, text generation and all, GPT will give you better accuracy. And for BERT, you may not get that kind of an accuracy. TF-Abbas pre-trained models, no. TF-Abbas pre-trained models for video data, audio data, text data and image data. It has pre-trained models for all types of data. Why can't we use TensorFlow app as we use Hugging Face models? See, Hugging Face as a single line of code. I'll show you. Just a single line. Tomorrow I'll be showing you, right? You'll understand. You saw the TensorFlow hub code, right? How much line of code you're writing. It is just usability. Easy. It is very easy for the user. That's why people are using Hugging Face. How much line of code we are using? So many helper functions, so many lines of code. It's very clumsy, right? Tomorrow I'll show you. In one line of code, you'll solve the problem. You will solve sentence classification. That's why I told you not to dip deeper into the code, because you don't require Hugging Face. In just single line of code, you'll solve the entire same task. You would solve it in single line of code. That's why I told you don't dig your head into the code and all, because tomorrow that will be shown to you, right? And that is why the popularity is because Hugging Face is very, very good, makes it very easy for the user. So everybody likes it. Everyone is lazy, right? Nobody likes to type to huge lines of sentences. If an API is very user friendly, then people will like it. But both are having same but pre-trained model only. But it's just that single line of code you're able to do it. And Hugging Face has got... Hugging Face has got a lot more advantages as well, which you'll get to know shortly. Can we use... TFHub for pre-trained models for image classification? Yeah, you can use, because I told you, right? TFHub has not only language data, it has got text data, it has got image data, video data, audio data, everything. You can use it for all. I think this question is coming up many times. I told you already. See, TFHub, you see TFHub, you have text data, image data. One minute, my sister is calling. See, you have image data, video problems, audio problem, not just text. You have around 1,500 pre-trained models for all types of data, not just NLP. TensorFlow Hub is for all types of data. I repeated it many times. Once again, I'm repeating it. Any good course you suggest for life sciences, please? Okay, tomorrow I'll share the good course for life. You want data science in life sciences, right? Tomorrow I'll share it, Sailesh. I'll add it in the Word document by tomorrow. I have a very general question. I've been seeing you taking you so many courses on NLP and CV, and you could really go good. It's inspiring. Just curious, how do you manage to learn so many things? Like, how do you manage time for these things? See, one thing which I will tell you is learning how to learn. Okay, it's a very good question which Shashant asked. It might be an offbeat question, not related to the NLP or the BERT. But I'll tell you, this is one of the most life important life for learning how to learn. See, I learned this, I came across this course, Learning How to Learn, in Coursera. I came across this course and it was one of the revolutionizing course. And I also read about this Professor Barbara Oakley's work. So this course will teach you how to learn the things at the right way, and how to learn things at the shortest span of time. This is one of the revolutionizing self-learning or whatever, self-improvement course which you can take. And this will help you optimize your time. And it will give you a lot of tips how to make advantage of your neural networks or your own brain, how to optimize your brain, how to be more productive, how to learn the right way. You'll understand more about the neuroscience of your brain, so you'll be able to tap your full potential. So this is one of the most important courses, I'll say. The other thing is the three important mantra in optimization is eating healthy food, exercise daily, sleep well. And definitely Indian foods are not going to give you all the necessary vitamins and nutrients. Please take health supplements. And definitely one supplement which I would recommend is omega-3 supplement, because that will not be in your food unless and until you eat salmon or things like that every day. So eat omega-3 supplements and eat multivitamin tablets, because you know Indian foods definitely don't have all the nutrients in a single shot. So eat healthy, exercise daily, sleep well, and have healthy habits, and that will be making you more productive. You will be able to achieve a lot, and you will be able to optimize your time in a better way, and you know, slowly you'll start seeing improvements in your life. This is what I do in my life. I take nutrition very seriously. I take you know, exercising very seriously, sleeping for 7 hours mandatory, and all these things very seriously. That will reflect upon everything which you do. And so this is what could be somewhat a relevant answer, but that's how I'm able to manage time. And what's the max length is equal to 512? What does it imply? So 512 is the so this I'll be the, you know, this is one this I'll be covering it tomorrow, because tomorrow you'll be learning it in depth. So that time you will be able to exactly understand what this 512 and all is. So tomorrow I'll be covering it in much more detail with some visualization and all. Today, if I just say it, you will not understand it. So I'll be showing some visualizations, and I'll be comparing the embedding vectors and all that. Can we get an different explanation, different kind of fine-tuning methods like adaptive, behavioral? I'll try to explain some of the different fine-tuning methods, but I'm not sure of adaptive fine-tuning method. Maybe I'll check and I'll get back to you. What algorithms like BERT uses, please? So BERT is an NLP architecture. There are a lot of algorithms which tomorrow we'll be going through it once again, because today we saw all the algorithms which we'll use, but if you've still not got it, I'll explain it once again tomorrow. Mostly machine translation you will be able to do using transformers architecture. You can go to the TensorFlow tutorials and you will be able to see machine translation here. Transformers, TensorFlow. So if you're looking for specifically tutorial on machine translation, then you can go to this library where they would have used an transformer architecture or BERT, I'm not sure. Wait, like. Yeah, so this is the tutorial for the official tutorial, and where you will be able to find some machine translation tutorials if that interests you. So you can use this. I'll put this link there, so you'll be able to find a lot of tutorials. Some people were asking some tutorials and all for the other types of tasks. So you can make use of the official tutorials from text. So if you want neural machine translation, here you have, I think, neural machine translation with attention. This itself is a paper from Google. Neural machine translation model itself is a paper from Google. And they've solved it using this. I think I would recommend that the person who asked about machine translation go through it. I'll just put it in the... So go through this article if you're more interested in machine translation. Whatever. Great. You own the neural machine translation development of Oracle Brown. Great. Then maybe you can share your insight. George Victor can share your insights. I have not worked on neural machine translation, but George Victor can share your insights tomorrow in the class for the others. What is it to do a neural machine translation for Oracle Cloud? I also have a government project which might come up in some time where I have to do a Chinese translation. I don't know that George Victor, if you can send me a LinkedIn request, I can get in touch with you. And all right, we've come to the end of the session and we'll catch up tomorrow. And we will, whatever, there were a lot of questions which you were asking today, which we will be covering, like max length, what is max length, what is layer, what is this normalization layer, why do we have a residual connection, and all this will be covered in depth in tomorrow. And a lot of people were again asking about the comparison of performance for which task, which architecture is very good and all that. And all that we'll be covering it tomorrow once again. And some of you were asking for Kaggle notebooks for all the glue task and all that. For example, for us takeaway and all that, those things will be given. Tomorrow and day after, we'll see Hugging Face libraries. We will be seeing some more real world use cases. And tomorrow and day after, the agenda will be to take all the concepts learned today. We'll be getting much deeper into it. The last day, we might extend a little bit where we'll be taking the research paper and we'll try to read out aloud and, finally revise it. That might take around 30 minutes. We'll just read the first 9 pages or 8 pages. And this is the agenda for tomorrow and day after. So let's catch up tomorrow. Maybe the last day will be a little lengthier day. Tomorrow also maybe a little lengthier day. Be prepared and come. And I would highly recommend, please go through the concepts today if you are somebody who's a slow learner or learning it for the first time, because tomorrow we'll be going in depth into these concepts. At that time, if you're not able to catch up, it is going to be difficult. So if you're learning NLP for the first time, please take your time and go through it so you can catch up with the other speed. And with this, we'll wind up. Take care and we'll catch you all tomorrow.
Thank you so much, Usha, for being with us. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining in today. And as Usha have already told you, the agendas for the next 2 days. So see you guys tomorrow, same time at 7 p.m. And we would really appreciate you all joining on time tomorrow. Yes, Sumit, the recording will be available. You can just drop in the link at alumni@upgrad.com. And just wait a minute. I'll just drop the link here. The recording will be updated in the next 24 hours. Yes, the joining link remains the same. Just give me a minute. I'm just dropping the recordings link for all of you. Here you go. So this is the recording link which I have shared. The reference material link is also updated in this sheet, and the recording link will also be updated soon. So you can access it easily. And yep, good night, everyone. Thank you so much for joining in. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.